Stephen Roach, of course, the famed economist, and now primarily at Yale University, going into academics. How are we now, Stephen?
What do you think, Susan? Yeah.
Probably a good life, isn't
yeah,
it?
Yeah, no complaints.
Okay, Steve, any complaints about these banks that are failing stress tests still after 4 years after the financial crisis?
Look, it's a stress test. It's an extreme scenario that the Fed has shocked these bank spreadsheets with, and not all of them made the cut, but the likelihood of a stress occurring of the magnitude that the Fed subjected these banks' financials to is extremely low. I would not be overly wrought about one or two not making the cut.
Yeah, you think the U.S. banking sector is pretty healthy these days? Well, J.P. Morgan's returning $15 billion or buying back $15 billion worth of its shares.
Well, I think it has been built up to withstand tough blows, but the system itself is a very different system than the leveraged balance sheet, capital markets, exotic security system that existed before we went into the crisis. So it's a lower return and I think more of a plain vanilla type system right now, post-crisis, than it was several years ago.
Yeah, how would you gauge the health of the U.S. economy right now? We heard from Ben Bernanke, says they're seeing signs of improvement, but interest rates are pretty much going to stay where they are until late 2014,
yeah,
something like that?
I wouldn't, you know, really. I know the markets surged on the hopes that the economy looks better, but what the chairman pointed out, which I think is really an interesting and important point, is that while the GDP has moved up only modestly, the improvement's been concentrated in the labor market, and the disconnect between rising employment growth, somewhat of a decline in unemployment, but still sluggish GDP. I mean, the first quarter GDP, it looks like it's, you know, 1.5%, which is nothing to write home about. So he's puzzled. A lot of us are puzzled, and I think the Fed remains cautious in that environment.
Okay, well, you know what everyone's trying to listen in for, you know, any hints of another round of monetary stimulus? So what do you think, QE3, is that just something in the clouds right now?
Well, I think the Fed remains predisposed toward monetary accommodation because they're not drawing a great sense of euphoria out of the state of economic recovery at this point in time. And their view is, with a weak recovery, given what we've been through, if you're going to make a mistake, you'd rather make a mistake with monetary accommodation rather than with monetary tightening. So I think they're still predisposed towards some easing, but, you know, they're data dependent like all of us.
Yeah, okay. Well, you know, there are some Fed members that want to raise interest rates this year, some want to raise it next year, 2013. Is there a risk of policy mistakes given what happened with Greenspan and his blame for 2008?
Yeah, you better believe it. I mean, you know, we've had a multitude of policy mistakes, fiscal and monetary, over the last three decades, and the Fed is certainly, you know, one of the leading institutions that I think has misread the interplay between asset markets, the real economy, and financial stability. They're human like everybody else. They promise they'll never do it again, but look, you know, they're human. They could make another mistake.
Yeah, well, it seems like there's still a lot of hope out there that we're going to get something, another round of bond buying, maybe some more operation
twists.
Well,
look, there's hope, but you have to ask yourself this. These are unconventional or / emergency policies. If the economy's in recovery, the unemployment rates come down to, you know, 8.25%, things are getting better, the markets are surging in response, do we need to keep policies at their emergency settings if the emergency is over? Doesn't that set us up for another round of excess in some aspect of financial markets, either in the U.S. or even out here in Asia? So I'm a big believer that once the emergency is over, you state that and then you return your policy levers to more normal settings, which would mean interest rates and not, you know, another surge of a quantitative easing.
Yeah.
But the Fed certainly sees it a little differently.
Yeah, some people believe that there's also a new normal as well. What's normal anymore is probably out the window. Stephen, quick question for you. What do you make of this euphoria on the markets? We were up 2% overnight on Wall Street.
Again, I think it's very much dependent on the interplay between the Fed and the real economy. The Fed did have a slight upgrade in its assessment. There's a lot of cash on the sidelines. People don't want to be left behind. But, you know, the markets have surged a lot more than the economy, and you have to ask yourself, who's got it right, the economic data or the investors? The investors will tell you, of course they do, and yet, you know, time and again, you got to raise some real questions when you see a disconnect like this.
Why do you think it vastly overblown these scenarios of a hard landing?
Look, Susan, the China story has been one that for literally decades has not really been well understood in the West. We tend to look at China historically through the same lens that we look at ourselves. So we see signs of excess investment, a lot of surge in property investment, a pickup in inflation. We say, the end is at hand. Chinese have a different value system in running their economy. Their focus is on stability. So when they see an inflation problem like they saw last summer, they go after it. And by the way, the inflation rate today is running at half the rate it was last summer. When they see a property bubble, they go after it. They put huge restrictions on multiple purchases of homes by speculators, and they're down, and the property market's cooling off. And the banking regulators are very, very tough in overseeing the exposure to risky loans.
Well, you're an academically trained economist. Is it normal it's definitely not. But is it normal for an economy to go through 10 years without a recession whatsoever? I mean, how can you not have a downturn in growth?
They've had a downturn. I mean, you look at what they had in late 2008, the financial crisis. The economy was, for China, in the functional equivalent of a recession. The export sector went from boom to bust in 7 months. 20 million migrant workers lost their jobs in Guangdong province. The GDP slowed precipitously, and they put a massive fiscal stimulus in to cap the downside. So that may not be a recession in terms of declining GDP by U.S. or European standards, but for China it was, and focused on stability, they don't waste any time. They went right after the downside.
Okay, so how do you read the Chinese economy? You said that hard landing scenarios are overblown, but we do have economic indicators coming down, retail sales missing, industrial output missing. I mean, even electricity use isn't where it used to be. So how do you gauge that and, I guess, relate it to the fact that we still have lots of workers getting 10% rises, 10%, 12%
raises? They still have a big export sector.
Right.
And their two largest export markets are Europe, number one, the U.S., number two. The last time I checked, Europe's in a recession. The U.S. is in a weak recovery. Of course, their exports are going to be weak, and that's going to bring down industrial activity. So they're getting subjected to an external shock.
But that's what I'm trying to point out, is that GDP growth is expected to come down. But yet, we talk to economists who say that these corporates can't find enough workers to meet production. So, what an interesting dynamic.
What's going on in China, Susan, is shifting the model, and it's got to occur very quickly from the external demand dependence to internal demand. This is what the new 12th five-year plan is all about. They're focused on it. I just came back from a week in Beijing. I'm going back up there again for a big conference over the weekend. This is the story in China, the transformation of the growth model in a post-crisis world of sluggish global demand.
And
they
have
to do it.
What about this leadership change? Does this affect the trajectory of China whatsoever?
The two leaders to be, Xi Jinping and Li Keqiang, are currently members of the nine-member standing committee. They signed on to the 12th five-year plan. There's no surprise. There'll be seven new members. There's some internal jockeying right now as to who they'll be. But I think this will be a smooth transition, just like the one was 10 years ago.
Okay. Now, you're teaching a few courses at Yale. One is on Japan, right? How to learn the lessons.
It's called The Lessons of Japan.
Yeah.
It's a great course.
Great course.
My students should be hard at work on their papers right now as we're talking.
I'm sure they are. Very, very scared of you, Stephen. And the other one, I assume, is on China.
It's called The Next China.
China.
It's a course about the transition.
Right.
To basically a consumer-led China.
And China is more interesting to you still than Japan?
Well, I won't say it's more interesting, but they're both fascinating transitional stories. China, the most extraordinary development story that I've seen in my lifetime. Japan, the biggest case of a dynamic Asian economy going from boom to bust that we've ever seen, and how they get out of that, and what does that mean for the rest of us? I mean, the U.S. looks Japanese-like in terms of its interest rates. So does Europe. Are there lessons? That's what we talk about.
Okay. Well, I got to say.
Why don't you sign up?
Yeah. Well, maybe I should take a summer course, you think? But do you even teach in the summer?
No. I write in the summer.
The holidays must be pretty good. That's the biggest, I think, transition for you from banking to the world of academics.
Yeah, but, I'm not on the beach, I'm writing, and I'm still doing a lot of research and travel.
You should come join us more often then.
Thank you. I'd love to.
All right. Stephen Roach, now at Yale University, joining us right here in our Hong Kong.